Henry Ferguson grew up on a dairy farm in Vermont and brings that early experience of the relationship of soils to the land to the center.
We actually had a soil survey going on in our town when I was growing up, and we saw these weird holes in the ground, and we wondered what they were. We all the kids called them snake holes, and apparently they were probe holes from the soil scientist digging all these holes in the ground. And eventually I met the soil scientist and even had a student internship with them and mapped soils in our town, or our county.
What got you into the education aspect of soils?
So while I was in Missouri, I went to a class that was put on by a Department of Natural Resources employee. Mm-hmm. And he did some really neat demonstrations on erosion. And it seemed like a fairly simple demonstration. And it's the first time I'd ever seen that one. There was also another one. We call it the slake test. They talked about taking a piece of soil from a fence row and comparing it to the soil in the middle of the field. It was like in the 80s and we were really into this highly erodible land, and so it made a whole lot more sense to compare soils from conventional till to soils from no-till. And it turned into something that you could use to actually communicate to people as to, if you change your management, you can change your soils, or your soils will change for you.
So the thing that makes a lot of these experiments and demonstrations work is a good solid database behind what we know about soil. How do we get all that data and information?
We've actually been working on the soil survey for over 100 years. People actually go out to the field, they dig holes, and they sort of characterize the soil. And when they can find a representative site, they dig a backhoe pit and they send samples into our lab. And those samples we then analyze, and we originally put the data on paper. So the big goal that we have now is to take a lot of the data that was gathered previously and try to get it in a central database along with all of the data that we've collected since the 70s and 80s and 90s when the computers were actually here. So there's still a lot of work to do. Of those 64,000 points, you can probably plot about 45,000 of them.
What's the difference between all this point data that you were talking about and what we see on the web and other places that are called soil maps?
The point data is the data that was used to characterize the soil, which we then use to represent map units on a map. So we actually have something called the Web Soil Survey where people can look for their piece of property and they can find these polygons, these areas of soil. You can bring up the map. And once you bring up the map, there are different tabs. And in one tab, you can look at the properties. And with the other tab is called the Soil Explorer tab, where you can actually see, well, what happens if I want to build a road? Or what happens if I want to build a house with a basement? Or if I want to put in a septic tank, what kind of problems might I run up into?
How large is the audience out there for all this point and mapped soils data?
So there are people all over the country that use the website every day. And there are times when occasionally the website goes down, and within seconds there are phone calls to our hotline. And our hotline will be very hopping and busy. Hopefully 15 or 20 minutes and we're back online. We know there's a demand out there because they call in and email us and they want it back as soon as possible.
I'm excited about this because we're finally turning that data that Henry, that I collected also for 15 years out in the field, that hundreds of other soil scientists collected. Finally, we're turning that data into information that can be used by the public.